I am ready. First things first, where I know we're starting on part two, but something I promised to do going on part was to give you this diagram. There's one over there for you guys to share, and there's one over here. This is my little diagram that shows what bodies of the government have the most power and what bodies have the least power.
Is this, there's a version of this in your CD, is that correct?
That is correct.
Do you want to make some sort of pitch for your CD, where people can get it and et cetera?
Most of they come to something like this, and I give them away for a reciprocal gift.
But some people are watching this on YouTube.
I guess the best thing to do would be to send me an email. I don't have a formal way of downloading it online. I know it's something I should do, but it's just another one of those things that hasn't gotten done. Mm. But I just send it out to somebody who asked for it. It is called The People's Liberty, which is the title for this series, because this is really based on my commentary.
Do you and have a kid or a nephew or somebody who knows how to do this?
No, I don't. I probably have a son who knows how to do it, but he's all there. So I can be educated, but the point of this is, if you look at this this chart, we have the general court, which is the legislature, and divided into the Senate and the House of Representatives. It's actually the House of Representatives and the House of the Senate. And then the executive, which is typified by the governor, and the judiciary. And what I did was draw an arrow from each box toward other boxes, describing what powers each had over the other branches. And I developed this for explaining the powers of government to the children, fourth graders. And then when you're all done, so you have, within the general court, each chamber, each house has a negative on the other, but only the house can start money bills, revenue bills, and only the house can start bills of impeachment. And then you look at the legislature as a whole, we have bills, which the governor can veto, that's an arrow back, and then a veto override, which is an arrow back toward the governor's. We also have a bills of address and bills of impeachment going toward the governor, toward the executive. And we have bills of impeachment going, and there should be going to the judiciary. And there's a bill of address arrow going from the executive over toward the judiciary, because the governor actually can ask for a bill of address. And we have an arrow carrying out the law to the judiciary, and then we have the adjudication of the law back toward the executive. And then what you do is you just count up who has the most arrows coming from their box. And you find out who has the most power. And it is the House, followed by the Senate, followed by the executive, and lastly the judiciary. So when somebody tells you that we have three co-equal branches of government, not so. There is nothing in any constitution that implies that the three powers of government are co-equal. That's something that comes purely out of the judiciary seeking to self-aggrandize themselves. And if you want to correlate that, you go back to, remember, Part 1, Article 1 defines our state as a Lockean social contract. If you go back and you read Locke identifies the legislature as the supreme power of government. So we have two ways going back to say, yes, the legislature is supreme.
But the legislature can still only act within the Constitution.
Correct, because that's created by the people from whom all power flows. But now we're starting on part two. And rather than, logically we would start at just part one, Article 1. The reason I don't want to start at Article 1 is for the definition of terms. Part 2, Article 1 is a very short article, but we have to understand what all the terms in Article 1 mean. So I'm going to take you on a little journey as to how I came to understand what the words mean. And that journey starts in Part 2, Article 6. We look at Part 2, Article 6.
What page do you got?
I'm just looking for it right now.
60?
I'll believe you.
What?
Part 2, Article 60. 6 is 60. Now, originally it wrote, the public charges of government or any part thereof may be raised by taxation upon poles, that's a head tax, estates, and then the next two phrases were not there until 1903. So estates, and there shall be an evaluation of the estates within the state taken anew once every 5 years at least, and as much oftener as the general court shall order. But in 1903, there was an addition, and it says, and other classes of property, including franchises and property when passing by will or inheritance. I looked at that and I said, what's a franchise? Are we talking about McDonald's? Obviously, that didn't make sense because there were not franchises of that sort in 1903. So I went and did a little word search. And if you look up in Black's Law Dictionary, a franchise is a power granted by the state, by the legislature, to do business in a manner not available to the general public. Next definition is something that we're more familiar with, you know, like the McDonald's franchise, where a company has granted power to do business not available to the general public. You're doing business under their license, as it were. So what is this power of franchise that the government gives? Hand that to me. Thank you.
You're welcome.
How is that?
Very good.
All right.
What is this power of franchise that the government gives? Well, if you go back and you look at how the government was organized, franchise is another phrase for incorporation. And if you go back before the 1960s, every franchise, every incorporation was executed by the legislature. In the 1960s, the legislature delegated the business of incorporation to the Secretary of State as a ministerial duty.
Are they authorized to do that?
No. Ha! But at least not philosophically, shall we say. But nobody's the wiser. So now you understand what a franchise is, a power given by the government to do business without, in a manner not available to the general public, i.e. without liability, individual liability.
That's the main thing in there.
That's the main thing in incorporation. However, you're making a trade, because once you're incorporated, the state tells you what your form of government must be. Does that sound familiar? This part two is called the form of government. They tell you what your, you know, who your officers must be, how often you have to meet. You have to give a report to the state every year as to what your business is. You cannot change your scope of business without permission from the state, or at least in these days, filing a fee. The state can dissolve your business at any time. So, in essence, you are trading your sovereignty for sovereign immunity, which is a power of the state. It's a power of a corporation. If you look at Part 1, Article 1...
I always understood that... As you said, that they can't be sued, but corporations do get sued.
No, corporations can be sued. The individuals who own the corporations can't be sued. Now, or the incorporations. The fundamental corporation is the state. If you go back to a 1784 dictionary, corporation is defined as body politic. That is the definition of a corporation. And the reason you have a corporation is A, to own property jointly. And so You build a state house, it belongs to the people, we own it jointly. And just as originally the king had sovereign immunity, the people have sovereign immunity in that we can't sue, if somebody trips on the state house steps, they can't sue Bill Almonts. They can sue the state. Or they can seek a petition for redress of grievance with the state for it to be made whole, if it were being done properly. But you begin to see what a corporation actually is. It has a purpose. The state recognizes two corporations, or two types of fundamental corporations. Itself and churches. By definition, a group of people meeting as a church are a corporation. And if somebody slips on the floor going into the church, they can't sue the members of the church, they can only sue the church.
But the state gets to decide what a church is.
No.
Well, it has been.
It has been, but under that philosophy, no. So, now let's look at Part 1, Article 1. The people inhabiting the territory, formerly called the province of the State of New Hampshire, do hereby solemnly and mutually agree with each other to form themselves into a free, sovereign, and independent body politic. Or state by the name, the State of New Hampshire. So we create the fundamental corporation. And that fundamental corporation, on occasion, grants franchise for certain types of business. Now originally, franchises were for things like ferries, insurance companies, and banks. And for lotteries. But your average person setting up a business didn't get a franchise. That was done by proprietorship. A proprietorship is how a member of the general public just does business. But when you do business as a proprietor, you're fully liable for your actions. During the 20th century, this became a motivation to seek the shelter of the state without really understanding what you were doing. This is definition of terms. So we create the body politic, the corporation of the State of New Hampshire. Now if you listen to certain people, they get very upset because they'll tell you, you can go on Dun and Bradstreet and you can find a corporation with the incorporation of the New Hampshire Supreme Court. And they're right. And I went and I looked up the incorporation of the Supreme Court of the State of New Hampshire. And it's on Dun and Bradstreet. I was very confused by this. But then I looked at the incorporation date. And it was the 1780s. So I had to think our founding fathers were okay with this. And in fact, there's an incorporation for the general court. And the funny thing is, and that was also incorporated in the 1780s, and who do you think the chief executive of the general court is? Any guesses? Who would be the chief executive of the general court? Think about what the structure of the state was in the 1780s. It changed in 1792.
Speaker of the House?
No. It's the governor, because the governor was the president of the Senate. Nobody ever changed the incorporation of the general court.
Hmm.
So it's still the chief executive of the state, which is actually improper now.
Whoa.
But was not at the time. But was not at the time. Because the president was a member of the legislature. And if you follow these things, every year, every term, as we go forward, one of the things we do is we divide up the rooms in the state house differently. And the Senate and the House of Representatives and the governor all trade deeds to state house rooms.
All do what?
Trade deeds to state house rooms if there's a shift in the distribution of the property of the State House. And you need those corporations to hold the deeds to the rooms.
Who trades?
The Senate, the House of Representatives, and the governor's office on occasion.
How do you hold deeds to public property?
Because they are a municipal corporation of the state. And actually, it's a little mind bending, but there has to be, you have a piece of property, there has to be a deed to it. Somebody has to hold that deed.
I will.
Right, I understand. But, so, and municipal corporations are, cities and towns are done just the same way. They're incorporated by the legislature. And they hold jurisdiction over certain plots of land.
So that construct, that concept is from the beginning?
Yes.
Well, who has the deed to all the state forests, for example?
The state forests? I'm sure they're held by the Secretary of State's office. That's what the Secretary of State does. He keeps all the papers of the state. The reason this is important is to understand the animal you're dealing with. Mm-hmm. And the fact that the founders did this starting in the 1780s means that it's not aberrant or repugnant to the Constitution. It's a management issue. But when you start dealing with incorporations and what is a franchise, in Part 1, Article 6, you need to understand the background, the underpinnings of what you're dealing with. So Article 1 simply creates the corporation, the body politic of the state of New Hampshire, so that we can act as a body.
What is the state? Is it a corporation? What is the state?
It is a fundamental corporation. It is a body politic. It's a group of people getting together and saying, we live in this territory called New Hampshire, and this is how we're going to govern ourselves. That's what that means.
And that's, now you're getting into those two seals.
Yes. Well, I wasn't going to, but that's what they are.
Yes.
One, the top seal, if you look at your book, the top seal, the one I wear, represents the Republic. It says the Republic of New Hampshire. It represents the Bill of Rights, that the underlying theory of government. And the second one is the seal of the state of New Hampshire. It represents the corporation.
What do the symbols here?
What do the symbols mean? The
five arrows. We need
Dick Marple. No, I know this one. I can't read the Latin, although I do know what it means. It's the Republic of New Hampshire, strength through unity stronger. The symbols are five arrows, the original five counties bound together, strength through unity stronger. And the two principal products of the state at the time, lumber and fish. Absolutely. We knew Portsmouth was the Annapolis of the North. We were a bigger seaport than Boston originally. That's why John Paul Jones's house is here, so to speak. Article 2. Now, so, I mean, you think of the progression, okay? Part 1 says, we are a state. I mean, Article 1 says, we are a state. Article 2 says, this is important. What's the first body defined? Well, first, in abstract, the legislature. The supreme legislative power in the state, shall, within the state shall be vested in the Senate of House and Representatives, each of which shall have a negative on the other. That's the fundamental structure of the legislature. Also note, anything that has not been amended after approximately 1950 has no title. So do not be limited by what the title says. It doesn't exist. In fact, if it hasn't been amended since probably 1841, it has no number either.
What is this about? If it hasn't been amended since 1950, what does that have to do?
Beginning in 1950, they began putting the titles of the articles on the ballot. And so when the people voted to adopt, to accept an amendment, they were also accepting a title. Prior to the 1950s, the titles of the articles were never put on the ballot. And originally, there were no titles nor numbers in Part II. The titles and numbers are an editor's note in 1841. I'm just going to
walk off camera here too.
Yeah, I'm just putting it within arm's reach. That was the purpose of my movement.
Then encourage longer questions.
The next article is describes the kind of the fundamental rules of the general court, which is the legislature. The Senate and the House shall assemble biennially on the first Wednesday of December. So we just did that. We just had Organization Day. For organizational purposes, in even number years, and shall assemble annually on the first Wednesday following the first Tuesday, just so that you can't have to assemble on January 1st, and at other such times as they may judge necessary. We dissolve at 12:01 on the first Tuesday of, I'm sorry, on the first Wednesday, at 12:01 a.m. on the first Wednesday of December. So last Wednesday, from 12:01 in the morning until we were sworn in, you had no legislature.
And the state ran fine.
Well, it still had an executive.
Exactly.
It still had an executive and a judiciary functional.
With no opposition, so.
So how safe were you? You can see we're going through first the legislature, and we're building up the basic powers. The general court, except as is otherwise provided in Article 72 of Part 2, shall forever have full power and authority to erect and constitute judicatories and courts of record or other courts to be held in the name of the state, and it goes on. But this is important. Until Article 72A was put into the Constitution, we created all of the courts, bar none. And with the power to create comes the power to uncreate, and we did so five times. When the courts were sufficiently displeasing to the legislature, we wiped the pieces off the chessboard and rebuilt the whole judicial system.
When was the last time?
Last time was 1873. We did it 1816, 1818, 1868, 1871, and 1873.
Jefferson had a lot to say about
the
periods of time like that.
What do you mean? In terms of frequency?
Yeah. Well, for example, he, the blood of tyrants and all, but he was also an advocate of every generation ratifying anew the founding charter.
Which, that wasn't really what happened. That was the legislature. And I would like us actually to be in the business of ratifying the contract with some frequency, because you don't, and that's essentially what a constitutional convention is. Mm-hmm. We haven't had a constitutional convention since 1984, I believe. Our legislature has become extremely fearful of having constitutional conventions, even good conservative individuals.
Well, there is something to be said for that opinion, given the zeitgeist.
But it's a right of self-rule.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, that's what I'm saying. And that's what Jefferson was saying when he said that every generation should be, because everything that's put into law, the founders, the Constitution to begin with, how do you encumber all future generations to your vote? It's wrong.
And I agree. And if you had regular conventions, which, if you have a convention, which, and the importance of a convention is that you have a semi-independent body being elected to make the rules for making the laws. The laws for the laws. And if you do that, and that body says, okay, we accept all, you know, 140 articles, except these five. So the people have elected deputies to look at the Constitution. The deputies agree they're all good except five, and they figure out amendments to five articles or maybe some additional articles, and those go before the people, and the people adopt two of them. Then the people have said, we accept the whole document with these two changes.
Who would be, if there were a vote to have a constitutional convention, who would be the conventioneers?
The delegates are elected in the same manner as representatives to the same districts.
So 400?
Yep, you'd have 400 delegates to the constitutional convention. And if the people are smart enough to elect 400 representatives to represent them, I suspect they're smart enough to elect 400 delegates to amend or not the Constitution.
But there'd have to be an election.
Yes, there is.
It'd be a hell of a fight over that.
In essence, you do it every 2 years anyway.
Yeah, but if there were going to be a convention.
No, the legislature.
Very narrow. Very narrow.
But the legislature has the power to propose amendments. You think about it, okay, and in a sense, you're probably a little more radical with a convention because there's only one chamber. You know, it's not bicameral, it's unicameral. But you have, any session, we can propose constitutional amendments. I've got two in that. If two-thirds of the legislature, 60% of the legislature approves the amendment, first the House and then the Senate, then they've recommended to the people for consideration, and two-thirds of the people have to approve it. If you have a convention, 60% of the convention has to approve it, and then it goes to the people, and two-thirds of them have to adopt it. So the process is really, it's, you're a little more likely because you don't have the, you know, the two bodies, but you're, it's no less power than you give the legislature every 2 years anyway. I don't see why everybody's so afraid of it.
Why would somebody want to have a convention since you can do it without the convention?
Because the legislature, in a constitution, the people have delegated power to the legislature. And the people say, you know, that legislature has too much power, or that the judiciary has too much power, or whichever. And we want to take some of it back. And so they elect delegates who will take some of that power back or shift it around here or there. The legislature is loath to offer an amendment that gives themselves less power.
Yeah.
Or any other branch of government.
But consider the first constitutional convention, where their charge was to modify the Articles of...
Don't mix conventions. That's federal. and...
Yes, but it's the same sort of thing that can happen. And
yes,
granted,
and no.
You've got the safeguards that the voters still have to vote for it, but the voters still ratify the Constitution over the Articles of Convention and...
Confederation.
Or Confederation. Right?
And that was a little different, but remember, the delegates didn't... This is a little known fact. The delegates didn't actually go off the reservation. The delegates went to the convention with a set of instructions. And they sat down, and they went over, and Madison proposed the new Constitution, and part of what they went in with was to strengthen the power of the general government, because it couldn't function. It was dysfunctional.
Didn't have enough money.
Right, because they
couldn't.
Well, they couldn't even pay their debts. I mean, you know, they had executed a war on behalf of the people, and they couldn't even discharge their debts. So they went into convention with instructions to amend. And they got there and they sat down, and one of the things you have to realize in the Articles of Confederation, all three powers of government were in the same set of hands. You had the Congress, and the president of the Congress was the chief executive. When they were out of session, they elected a body of individuals from the Congress to function as the executive. And the only judicial function, which was one of appeal, was handled by a committee of the legislature elected by the legislature. So you had and a lot of the states had the same type of government, including New Hampshire. So they looked and they said, with all the power we're going to give, all the new powers, it's actually only five new powers, with the five new powers we're going to give this government, we really need to divide it, make it into a divided government with a separate legislature, executive, and judiciary. And that was such a massive change in the form of government, they said, we really got to write this thing over. And they went back to their states and they said, we really have to do a rewrite on this. Will you give us new instructions? And the states did give them new instructions. So they didn't really go off the reservation. That's why New York didn't vote on the Constitution. They didn't get instructions.
Courteous.
All the other states got instructions, saying, yes, you can give us a three-part government rather than a one-part government. That was the big radical change.
So the idea of three separate groups and a government was really, what, late 1780s?
1780s, yeah. We went from a very unitary government with a 1776 to a three-part, or a more three-part government in 1784, and a fully three-part government in 1792.
So the three-part government didn't come because they had learned from Europe and otherwise. We had tried the one part and it wasn't working well.
Right.
And so this was another...
We kept diffusing the power more and more.
Where did the idea of a legislative, executive, and a judicial list?
Well, those are the three... Montesquieu talks about the three powers.
We don't have it any place else in the world, do we?
Oh yeah, because those are the three functions of government. Legislative, executive, making the laws, enforcing the laws, and adjudicating the laws. The question is, how do you organize them? You never get away from those three powers of government. Whether it's a single individual, a king making the laws, sending out his sheriffs, and appointing his judges, or you have something like the United States or the state of New Hampshire, where you have three truly semi-independent powers of government.
So before 1780, whatever it was, were there other governments which were doing the three separate things that we copied from? Or did somebody just come up with that and said, hey, we need three? I always had heard that this was
I don't know
unique to the United States. Now, what you're saying is it was sort of a natural. we set it up in a certain way, but it was sort of a natural.
It was a development in the United States, because the original states and the Articles of Confederation were not three-part governments, generally speaking.
But there was power transferred to the feds that, in my humble opinion, was never intended to be transferred. The Interstate Commerce Clause, for example, the problem was interstate tariffs. Can't have that. We need open commerce. We need free trade, and states are impeding this through protectionism. And so the feds say, well, we're going to transfer the authority to make interstate commerce regular.
Well, I believe that there has been a usurpation in power that was never intended by the Constitution.
Yeah.
I do not believe that there was a delegation of power that was not intended.
Okay. Functionally, it's been delegated.
What they said was, we want to put the job of regulating commerce between the states at the federal level,
but
the general level rather than the state level, because we've got border wars.
Yes, exactly. And that was because of the protectionism by state tariffs,
right,
saying our tradesmen need an advantage, so
right,
the other state has to pay
to get in here.
And it's not something that was intended.
Well, what was intended
from
what was intended was to take down the barriers between the states.
Yes.
What
we've done is put up barriers at the federal level.
But that didn't happen until the mid-1800s.
But did people like Hamilton anticipate it?
I don't think so. I don't think that was, I don't think so. If they had, I think they would have been more circumspect in how they put it. Now, there was an issue with the 10th Amendment. And
there's still an issue with the 10th Amendment.
Well, but there was an issue with the 10th Amendment when it was originally put in. They said expressly delegated, and expressly was taken out. The reason it was taken out was was not a bad one. They didn't feel you could actually write every jot and tittle that you really wanted to consider express in there. The problem was, without having something to that effect, it allowed them to stretch the Interstate Commerce Clause to something that was unrecognizable. I mean,
which they've done.
Right. When not buying something from another state is interstate commerce, the world is on its head. But that's an issue of mankind. I
want to return to this thing of the three. You're sort of saying that there's a natural three-part split for government.
There are three.
I guess I had never thought about that.
There are three natural functions, and from Locke to Montesquieu, all the writers of that period talked about the three powers of government.
Well, but if it were that obvious, has every country in the world adopted that? I don't think so. I don't know enough about it.
Some have, some haven't. Whether or not they are three separate powers, those three powers exist in every government. That's the issue.
Whether it's a dictator, a king.
Yeah, the Soviet Union had courts. They had a legislative body and they had an executive. Did they have a control? Did they have a government controlled by the people? No. They still had those three functions, even if they were kangaroo courts.
The trick is having them adversarial, jealously guarding their power, and you can stack it rather than three segments of federal government. You can stack it the other way when you've got states and federal and the people.
I wasn't as concerned about that. I'm proud of it. Maybe my problem. Okay. I'm looking at it, and you're making out that there's always those three things anyway. Just a question of how you arrange them and how you have to play against each other. And I guess what I'm saying is that if it was that damned obvious, then we ought to see it every place in the world, and we don't.
Well, we don't have republics or even democracies.
You're not saying maybe why it didn't happen. I'm asking, it ought to...
What you're saying is the division of the three ought to be obvious.
That's right. And that's therefore, we ought to find that essential thing in just about every government, and we don't.
No. That's not, no.
So what?
You know, because it's obvious that... You can ask the question, can you come up with a fourth function of government, or can you consolidate three into two? And I would argue that that's, either one is rather difficult to do, but regardless, that if we can all agree that this writing the laws and enforcing the laws and adjudicating the laws, if there are more or fewer than those, what the government does it really have a relationship to what logic says it should do?
Well, if you're arguing the government's not logical, I'll agree with you. Okay? what I'm saying is that Dan is saying that this is, I mean, almost, he's saying that these are the essential.
The three essential powers of government, to wit, the legislative, executive, and judicial. Part 1, Article 37.
Can you add a fourth?
You're arguing whether it could be.
Can you imagine a government?
I had never heard anybody say that those are the logical things and we happen to have adopted a way of them. I had always heard that this was something that the founders had sort of come up with. We got to arrange it so they fight each other. The government is to fight each other. You always want to make it.
I like that. Yeah.
Well, The unique thing that America developed was the three powers of government fighting each other. That was what we developed. But that those are the three powers of government is a discussion that existed at least two or three centuries before the founding of the United States. The question is how to arrange them in a manner that most preserves liberty. I mean, even Great Britain is an evolving implementation of those three powers. If you go back to the 12, if you go back before the Magna Carta, everything rested with the king. And then you have the Magna Carta.
And it's a more fluid version since they don't have a written constitution.
Right. And you know, the development of a bicameral legislature, one of which is controlled by the king and his lords, and the other which is controlled by the commoners. That is a system of government that developed over 800 years?
Well, I'm not arguing that. I mean, I agree that government is logical, and the concept, I guess what I'm having a problem with is, maybe you're right that those are the three essential functions, but they could be split. I could imagine getting a couple lawyers together, they could split the thing different ways. I don't know, I haven't really thought that through. But put a couple of lawyers down there, and I expect they can come up with different things. But what I understood about the Constitution and the form of government was that these guys got together in Pennsylvania, Philadelphia, wherever the hell they were, and they basically didn't trust politicians. That, I think, was a...
Well...
I wouldn't go that far.
I wouldn't say they didn't trust politicians. They didn't trust mankind in general.
Okay.
And figured that those who were in government were no better or worse than the rest of humanity. As much as any individual can be corrupted, the individuals in government can be corrupted. The idea of separating the government into different parts began at the state level and was then adopted at the general level.
Well, where was the first what was the genesis of this thing of, we want to make it so that nobody could really take over?
Probably Massachusetts.
I think he means earlier. Like Locke and Rousseau and...
Locke doesn't really talk, Locke speaks more fundamentally than Montesquieu. Probably Montesquieu, but Montesquieu was commenting on the British form of government versus the French form of government, which was very unitary, but unitary in one person, as opposed to unitary in a group of people, which is kind of an oxymoron, but, you know.
That's like government.
American governments were unitary in a group, not in an individual, in their first implementation in 1776.
See, I don't remember when I was being taught history and things like that.
Most people, but
that
we don't.
That I ever heard the concept. I learned it recently, but I mean, the last 20 years or so, that the government was really set up to be essentially antagonistic, so no one group could take
well,
it over.
And so,
Donald ran on? I mean, he just basically said, you know, you gotta clean this thing up.
Well, that's, the whole idea is enlightened self-interest. That, it's a beautiful phrase.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's like an informed electorate.
Well, no, enlightened self-interest means that you are going to
not
do
dangerous.
What you're naturally going to work for your own betterment. But if you have a common worldview and you have a government like ours, you're going to do so in a manner that betters everybody. Because just taking down everybody else around you leaves you with nobody to work with. The idea that, you know, the whole idea of divided government like we have is A, at each level, if you have three powers of government reasonably distinct, then if one branch of government attempts to get more powerful than was designed by the people, the other two can gang up against it and put it back in its box. And similarly, if one of the states or one or more of the states become totalitarian, our Constitution guarantees to each state a Republican form of government, our federal Constitution, and the federal government is a big hammer to prevent a totalitarian government arising in the states. Similarly, if the federal government were to become totalitarian, you're supposed to have the states, which could rise up against a totalitarian government and put it in its place. That's the design. You have competing powers, all of which are controlled by the people.
Well, states lost a lot of their power with the 17th Amendment.
Yes, functionally, yes.
What was the 17th Amendment?
Direct election of senators.
The states.
That was like it was, if I may. That was like I was talking about before. The you've got executive, legislative, and judicial. If laterally in the federal level, vertically you've got the states, the feds, and the people, and all three of them were supposed to be represented at the federal level. The people represented by their directly elected representatives. The president represented the federal level, and the states, the individual states, at this point 50 of them, which are supposed to be co-equal, were represented by the Senate, two senators each. And when the senators were no longer representing that state legislature, which is equally jealous of its 10th Amendment power, then the state legislature could recall them and put someone else in who would actually respect the 9th and 10th Amendment and allow them to retain more of their power. 17th Amendment said that that's no longer the case anymore. The states were ripped away from that table, the state legislature. And there's no one protecting the 10th Amendment in Mordor on the Potomac anymore.
Well, and if you think about it, Our senators are elected by 700,000 people, give or take. How many can a majority of those individuals have intimate knowledge of those senators? Originally, they would have been elected by 424 legislators who are obsessed with politics. And when the senator goes off the reservation, they're going to remember. And that person will not be put back in office.
And you're talking about 700,000 in New Hampshire.
Sure.
How many, what's the constituency in California?
30 million. Think about that.
They don't give a shit about you.
Has anybody proposed that go back to?
Oh, that wouldn't, the people said, yeah, I want to be able to vote directly, and that was done.
Well, not the people, but convention, actually.
But the people had to ratify.
The conventions in every state for the purpose, or I don't know if it went to the legislatures. Maybe it just went to the legislatures. And the reason it was done was because there were legislatures that were so divided they couldn't agree on having a senator in Washington to represent them. And so states would go unrepresented for extended periods of time in the Senate. And so wouldn't it be better if the people just elected them so that you wouldn't have all this politics interfering?
Gosh darn politics.
But you could solve part of that by just going back so that the two senators were elected by the entire state rather than the district.
No, they are elected.
Senate's, that's one of the reasons.
Well, that's right, you have to think that's right.
But that's not. That's,
but we've digressed. It's just so fun to digress.
Yes, we got to get back to the state. But that's never going to get rolled back.
You want the smoke-filled room? I know you.
I want smaller government. I want smaller political jurisdictions.
The fun part would have been if we had had a second term with Bill O'Brien or someone of his ilk. There is evidence that California never ratified the 17th Amendment. In fact, no legislative action on it can be found at all by the Secretary of State of California.
Pish posh.
It means it was never ratified.
Move along, Douglas.
Wait a minute, but they only need 3/4 of the states to ratify.
No! 3/4 minus California. They got the 3/4.
All the states but California are ratified.
No. I didn't say all
they
the states.
Stop counting after.
I just said California's ratification can't be found.
Was that critical?
Mm-hmm. It's the 38th. Or the however many of them. So we only had 48 states at the time. This is 36th vote. And they can't find the ballot box.
Huh.
I was going to have
just cut it off and ship it out to some other country.
Josh Davenport was supposed to put in the inquiry in the second year and forgot. And all isn't that hurt? Because all we were going to do is we're going to have an investigation by the committee to see if we could find California's ratification. What happens when you have a state legislature come out with a report that California can't find its ratification?
I don't know. That seems kind of difficult to justify to the New Hampshire taxpayers, though.
It doesn't cost them anymore. It doesn't cost them a dime.
Well, all right. Just a 15-second interjection here. That takes time. And there's analysis of what each individual LSR costs, and
so you put in more LSRs, so they each cost less.
Hey, I want to get back to one session ever biennium.
There was never such a thing.
Huh?
There was never such a thing.
Why wasn't there ever such a thing?
Because every year when they had only biennial sessions, in the second session they had a special session that was just about as large as a regular session.
Continuously?
Yeah.
What happened? I didn't hear what you said.
When we had biennial meetings of the legislature for, it wasn't long, it's about 30 years. In the second year, they would end up with a special session that was nearly as large as a regular session. The answer is there are problems to be solved every year. Originally we had...
And every year we get closer to perfect government. The second year should be dedicated to repeals. I want that LSR stuck in.
Bills of redress.
Oh man, has he ever been in the legislature?
No. No, Don, back to Don Gorman, no. He laughs anytime anybody proposes that. I'd be in the well with a cane, and I would use it on somebody within the first 2 weeks.
That's why my wife doesn't go into the legislature. So, people say, because she's very vocal, people say, oh, you guys ought to run as a couple. She says, no, she'd kill somebody. It takes a certain amount of patience.
More than I have.
So Article 4 is the establishment of the courts. Article 5, what time is it? I'm going to have to go in about 20 minutes. So I really want to get on to Article 6. Article 5 is pretty vanilla. It's the power to make laws. So we have the power to ordain, establish all manner of wholesome, reasonable orders, laws, statutes, ordinances, directions, and instructions, either with penalties or without, so long as the same be not repugnant or contrary to this Constitution, as they may be judged to be benefit and welfare of this state. It's very, very straightforward. We have the power to make laws. And then there's some additions on that we shall not allow the towns to invest in companies, things like that. So there's some laws, general power to make laws, and some prescriptions of laws. And it also there gives us the ability to impose and levy proportional, reasonable assessments, rates, and taxes upon all the inhabitants of and residents within the said state. So there's an important thing there is that Article 5, as a particular type of law that is authorized, authorizes us to create laws for revenue. And Article 5A is continuity in case of enemy attack or other events. Article 5B allows us to do things like current use tax or to give special property tax rates based on the use of the property. But what I really wanted to get to was Article 6. It's very important. It is actually what types of taxes. So Article 5 says you can levy taxes. Article 6 and its daughters are the types of taxes we can raise. So the public charges of government, and this is again is important. Remember we talked about fees. Fees are not generally considered public charges. Public charges of government are more general. A fee or a toll is a tax for a particular use. The use of a road, the use of a park, the use of a court. You're paying a particular tax. But this is the public charges of government or any part thereof may be raised by taxation among polls. That's a head tax. And we have several towns that still use a head tax. Estates and other classes of property, including franchises and property passed by will or inheritance, 1903, and there shall be an evaluation. Now, can anybody tell me what kind of tax is not in that list? No income tax in that list, no sales tax in that list. So, you know, though we've had a movement on occasion to say, for an amendment to say we can't impose an income tax, I would argue we can't impose an income tax because we haven't been authorized to. One of the things that was in the 1902 convention notes was a discussion on that addition of franchises and other property when passed by will or inheritance. And the comment was, you realize that if it is your objective that this does not authorize an income tax. And the answer was, yes, we know that. Income is not property. Very important distinction. Anybody here have any knowledge of accounting?
Does that mean that no income tax could be put in without a
constitutional amendment? Yes.
Which requires triple majority.
Yes.
Anything? Sales tax is safer.
Yes. Now this is an important thing because remember it says you can raise taxes on franchises. If the business enterprise tax, business property tax, and the Reuben Nielsen tax are valid taxes, it is because they are franchise taxes. They are taxes upon entities who have been specially authorized to do business without liability upon the owners.
So if the owner can't be taxed because that would be an income tax. But if he has a business, then he can be taxed because of
the business can be taxed. There's a problem with this, and I've tried a couple times to get it fixed. The business enterprise and business profits tax are levied on proprietorships. If it is a valid tax, it is because it is a franchise tax. If it is a franchise tax, it can only be levied on franchises. Should not be. No, there's tax on his property. He owns a mechanic's garage. That mechanic's garage is property. It has equipment in it. That's property. It can all be taxed. The profit cannot be taxed.
Well, if I were just doing something, a little business myself, consulting, whatever, then I can't be taxed.
You should not be able to be. Yes.
That's what I can't be taxed. But years ago, I had a bust with them, but turns out that they pay taxes in Massachusetts where I worked with my money.
That's different. You go by their constitution
there. But they wanted to tax me because I paid enough to get over the threshold was on the business enterprise tax, I guess.
And I have a proprietorship, and I am part of.
I should have just told them to stuff it, right?
Well, I wouldn't just tell them to stuff it, because right now it is in law that proprietorships are taxable under those taxes. What we have to do is get the legislature to recognize the impropriety, no pun intended, of taxing proprietorships under those taxes. They should just be stricken from the list. Again, it's all just understanding what the words mean. And understanding too, I mean, income is not property. Your income is not property until it is in the bank. It is a transfer of property. They authorize one transfer of property. They authorize a transfer of property by will or inheritance, and they use the term transfer. They did not authorize a transfer, the taxation of a transfer of property by income.
So are you saying that once you put the money in the bank, it's not property?
Yes.
So then, What we should do is just keep...
While it's floating through the air, okay, while it's in transit, so to speak, it is not property. It's not property until it is part of your holdings. Now, if you wanted to tax income, there is a way to do it and not violate that article. If you're familiar with accounting, annual change in financial position, that is how much property you own this year and how much property you own last year, must equal your net income. That's a fundamental equation of accounting. You could tax the change in annual change in property, which would in effect be a tax on net income, but you're taxing property or a change in property. That would be valid. It would also have an interesting aspect, because if you think of how you progress through life, you're a young family, income effectively equals outgo most of the time, right? Very, very little gets saved initially. So your tax on your property increase would be negligible. You get to your 40s and 50s and now you're accumulating wealth at a more rapid rate usually, and you would be paying on that accumulation of property. And when you retire and you're now living off your accumulated property, unless you're extremely wealthy, you know, you're so much so that your annual increase in your holdings exceeds your consumption, you would pay no tax. Just a thought out there, if you understand the limitations of our government. And it's beautiful because it ties right back to Part 1, Article 12. Part 1, Article 12 says, every individual has a right to be protected by the state in the enjoyment of their life, liberty, and property. Okay? What taxes could I impose originally? A poll tax, life, liberty, and an estate tax, property. I was paying a tax because the state was doing its job. If the state wasn't doing, in regard to me, if the state was not doing, hey, I died, I didn't owe the poll tax, right? If the state was not doing an adequate job of protecting my power to enjoy my property, accumulate wealth, then I would pay no taxes. It's an amazingly tight document.
Rather federal document like that.
Federal document, A, other than by abuse, it didn't need to be that tight because it wasn't supposed to be doing that much. If you have a government that can only do a handful of things, how tight do you have to make it?
So the same taxes that you could put in New Hampshire, which would not be sales taxes, which would not be income tax, but they would be funny kinds of taxes.
Well, that's what we exist on now. One of the reasons New Hampshire is so stable, generally economically, is it doesn't have a single tax that is the 1,000-pound gorilla in the room. We have a tapestry of small taxes, and it makes us fairly recession resistant because it is unlikely that everything gets hit at once. And truly, most of your taxation is local. The biggest tax most people pay is their town property tax, and that's the one they volunteer for.
I wouldn't call it volunteer, but the point I think the point you're getting to is that much of it is user fees as opposed to broad-based taxes, sales taxes, and income taxes. And whenever this subject comes up, I like to revert to Mark Twain, in one of his books, Pudd'nhead Wilson, every chapter of which started with a little aphorism, and one of them that I retained from high school was something to the effect that the wise man, or the fool says, do not put all thine eggs in one basket. Which is a manner of saying, spread your stuff around. The wise man saith, put all thine eggs in that basket and watch that basket. That basket is the income tax. Everybody's watching that basket. You spread it around, you start adding more and more tax and more fees. You got a dollar here and 50 cents there, and you can't keep track of it anymore. One tax, and everybody notices.
You never get rid of the tax.
Boom.
Always add it.
Yeah.
That's the problem.
Well, our one tax, if you will, is the property tax.
Yes, that's what I'm saying.
And it's
watch that basket.
And it's fairly well self-imposed. Well,
yeah, because everybody pays for it. Even if you're a renter, paying.
But even if you're a renter, you can go to town meeting, you can vote on the ballot.
Yes, yes. It's more locally controlled. Yes, absolutely.
The town property tax, the legislature that imposes the town property taxes are the people who live in the town. And in that sense, it is self-imposed. Now, it can be but again, that's what happens when people don't show up to session, so to speak.
But I would still say it is not self-imposed. It's more locally imposed. It's by 10,000 people instead of 1.3 million
right,
or 300 million, but it's still not self-imposed.
You see, I want to put in an amendment that says whatever tax you put in has to be approved by the group of people so defined to pay.
Well, that's the way the property tax
that's
is.
A user fee. That's a user fee, right. And I am all in favor of user fees. Right.
Well, you're easy.
She's just staying out of it.
I don't get any.
We're really getting to the point that I do have to go, but a couple of things will bring us to a very good conclusion here. Okay, 6A is the highway taxes, which is gasoline tax, registration, and license fees. And this is a constant subject in the legislature. And people complain that it's used for other things. The problem is the state police were one of the reasons to impose Article 6A. That was why it was adopted. That was part of the minutes of the convention. So as long as the cold case unit isn't being paid for by the gasoline tax, but only the guys patrolling the highways and their supervisors, that's legitimate.
Is it that way it's done?
I haven't gotten a good answer on that yet. A verifiable answer.
Why is that not a surprise?
Well, it's not one of my big things, so I haven't put in the bill for the audit. I've tried to get people who are into that thing, the Neil Kirks of the world, etc., to just ask for the audit, find out how many jobs, people's salaries were paid for by highway taxes in 1992 after the last major increase then, and how many jobs there are being supported by it now. If the number of jobs hasn't changed significantly, if there haven't been a whole bunch of managers added to the rafters or something, then you're really dealing with effects of inflation. And there are actually reasons why the gasoline tax would have to go up. cars are more efficient. So you're selling fewer gallons of gasoline per vehicle mile. We know that the cost of the asphalt has gone up. So there are real, and we know the value of the dollar has gone down. So there are, and it's a constant, it's a constant tax. It's not, you know, so many percent per gallon, it's so many cents per gallon. So there are real pressures that would cause the gasoline tax to rise. On the other hand, we have not a clue as to what was being paid for then and what's being paid for now. Not a clue. Article 6B is the lottery, which is created to pay for help pay for education. First one in the nation. It was actually after the lottery was started, but that's okay. But what it really does, because the legislature often in early times would institute lotteries for various purposes, this ensured that the money from the lottery would go toward education. Article 7 is an interesting one, and we have something going on in the legislature this time in the other body that skims right along Article 7. Article 7 was instituted in 1792 because between 1784 and then, legislators would take fees for introducing petitions for redress. So they were making money off of their office.
So there were sleazy lawyers back then?
They weren't necessarily lawyers. And in fact, the guy who put in the amendment, whose seat I effectively held, William Plummer, was in fact himself a lawyer. And put in this amendment. Now, so when you read, no member of the general court shall take fees, be of counsel, or act as an advocate in any cause before either branch of the legislature, and upon due proof thereof, such member shall forfeit his seat in the legislature. You have to put that in the context of taking a fee for introducing legislation. Now, we have an individual who is the president of the NEA in New Hampshire, making $200,000 a year, who has advocated on bills, has been elected to the legislature. Does that violate Article 7? Probably not, because he's not really making money off of his seat. He was making the money before he obtained the seat. But is it problematic? Yes. There is a bill introduced to study the matter, or a resolution to study the matter. Just to come up with, is this something we should do something about?
Now it says, or act as an advocate.
But an advocate at that time, it would be taking a fee for introducing a piece of legislation. In those days, what they were really talking about at the time is petitions for redress. But say somebody paid me $100 to introduce a bill to legitimize poker in New Hampshire. That would clearly cross this line. I'm going to pay you, I want you to introduce a bill to legitimize poker. Give me $50 and I will. That would cross the line. Clearly, unequivocally.
So this guy is going to be getting paid.
And that's
for the NEA.
Well, he's already paid.
He is not working for the NEA, he's working for the legislature.
Yeah. Is he going to get a reduction in pay? Is he going to be putting in his, I mean, a lot of us hold full-time jobs in the legislature, some of us do anyway, and simply shift their work schedules around the legislature. So do you know that he's not going to be putting in as many hours?
And it's merely expected that you recuse yourself
right
from relevant bills.
Well, that will be one of the things to watch. Does he recuse himself from all of the education and union votes? But it's this is, you know, historically important. And the last one we're going to touch on tonight is Article 8, open sessions of the legislature. The doors of the galleries of each house of the legislature shall be kept open to all persons who behave decently. So we can throw somebody out for contempt of court, who behave decently except when the welfare of the state and the opinion of either branch shall require secrecy. This was violated by my good friend Bill O'Brien, in my opinion. He, during the debate on right to work, certain individuals in the gallery were disruptive and heckling the legislature. And he closed the gallery. I do not, did he actually look to see who was contemptuous of the legislature and throw them out? No. Was everybody being contemptuous? No. Was it a situation that demanded the secrecy, that the state's safety just required secrecy? I don't think so.
Well, he should have spoken on individual people.
I would believe so. I would have sent some, I would have sent somebody up there to, you know, out of the sergeant at arms office to that guy, and that. But then, can he throw them out? No. It's a vote of the legislature. Or without objection, I eject so-and-so. Or put them in prison. We can put them in prison for however long we wanted. But we didn't do that. We didn't do what we were constitutionally authorized to do. And when you, and the funny thing was a member of the other party challenged the ruling of the chair, and a number of his leadership voted against it. Oh yeah, I was not alone. The Pauls, Al Baldessaro, he lost. He had a bunch of constitutionalists in his chairman seats, and a bunch of his chairmen said, What's the vote was there? Do you uphold the ruling of the chair? No, can't. We were all called into the office. And he said, why did you? I said, because my opinion was unconstitutional. And particularly me, I said, yo, you put me chairman of the committee to defend the Constitution. And he says, well, he said to me, well, can I ask you not to do that again? And I said, if I leave the room, is that enough? And he said, yes. So that would be a clear indication of.
Uh-huh. You people get anything done up there?
I prefer they didn't get anything done, really.
The funniest thing I ever saw, and I've seen it several times since, the first time I saw it was during Doug Scammon's term as speaker during my tenure, was a debate for about 40 minutes on whether or not to limit debate. And I've seen it four or five times since. And the motion usually fails. So Which is good. Well, and the fun part is you have all these people getting there curmudgeonly. The first time it happened to me, all these people saying, oh, this is stupid. I said, sit back and enjoy it. Could you ever buy a floor show like this? You couldn't buy this kind of entertainment. Just sit back and go with the flow.
We gotta clean that swamp.
There's a lot of swamps in Cleveland.
I would say our swamp is probably the shallowest.
Well, yeah.
And the reason for that is we don't make any money.
Yeah, but they ought to be at the zero salary. That way you can pay.
Wouldn't make any difference.
Because $100 is an insult.
No, it's not. It's an honorarium.
Yeah. And they get free tolls, so, you know.
Yeah.
I'm good with that.
Be zero.
I'm good with that. I'm fine with $100 a year.
No, it's an insult.
It's not. No. No, I disagree. I don't feel insulted by it at all. It's a curious badge of honor. The interesting thing was that it was never intended to be what it is. When it was set at $100 a year.
$100 a year was worth something.
Or $200 a term. It was one third of the annual salary of the average railroad worker. The railroads were very powerful at the time, and that was how it was set. So it was not, it's just never been adjusted. If you wanted, and if you wanted to be literal, that was adopted in 1889. What was $100, what was $200 a term in 1889?
It was like $20,000.
No, it wasn't that much, but it was 100 silver dollars.
Yeah.
That was the definition of a dollar.
See, I was thinking 1913 as you were talking.
Right. We literally should be paid 200 silver dollars at the beginning of each session.
When are we going to meet again?
You
going to have a debate on that?
I haven't thought it out. Probably, well, do we want to try and do it in January?
What?
Do we want to try and do it in January? You're driving you're not driving that far, are you?
Yeah.
And I know how far you're traveling. Maybe we can get some more people to come.
That would be good.
It would be good. Though people are watching it online.
Did you settle with like Saturday or is it when you're gonna have?
No. Well, I think we should keep it on Sunday nights because that way it won't interfere with the legislature. This is the second Sunday of the month. There's nothing. Second Sunday of the month in January would put it at the 7th. That's a little early. Sunday's the first, that's what I was thinking.
You want to go back to the last Sunday?
Yeah, I think so. I think that's a good thing to do. Let's go back to the last Sunday of the month in January. Sounds good. No, I've never worked on discoursing on articles on the second part before. And that's really where most of the commentary has grown over the years. I gave Brandon Finney a copy, and it caused me to go back and look. And when I first wrote this 10 years ago, I first completed in December of 2006. It was, I think, 85 pages, and it's now 129.
Yeah.
And that's due to just every term taking what we have pondered over constitutionally and expanding that article.
Sure. Somebody's got to do it.
Last term it was, what is a money bill? It's an obscure thing. Well, the Constitution of the United States got much more direct and they quit using the term money bill and said revenue bill. And our interpretation comes from Massachusetts. We'll get there later. Our interpretation comes from Massachusetts. And in New Hampshire, it came out of like a the introduction of a property tax exemption.
You want to state why this is relevant?
Well, it's relevant because the description in Massachusetts, the description was money bill referred only to direct taxes, not indirect taxes. And that comes from a 1780s or 90s comment by a Massachusetts jurist, not part of a case. It was just a comment. Somebody recorded. And it was relevant to Massachusetts because Massachusetts constitutionally had the power for indirect taxes in that they had imposts and duties. So you have an indirect tax. Mm-hmm. In New Hampshire, as you've seen reading Article 6, we had no indirect taxes. So how could you made the distinction of whether or not money bill referred to only direct taxes or included both? We didn't have indirect. You couldn't make that distinction.
But why is money bill
because it,
important to New Hampshire governments?
Because money bills must originate in the House of Representatives. They can be amended by the Senate, but they can only be originate in the House. And last year we had a money bill originate in the Senate, which is what sparked the whole discussion. And there were those of us who were somewhat incensed, as much as one needed to be, but it caused me to go back and figure out what is the definition of money bill and where did we get ours? And we got ours from a nonsensical location.
Thank you very much.